I'm tired of Gmail, and if you clicked here, you probably are too. Email is not a battleground for ads and data mining and all the other shenanigans from big tech. I'm gonna share my 5 must-try options for better email, as well as 3 honorable mentions just to give you some extra stuff. Now, the key criteria for what I'll use for this video, just so you have an idea of why I picked these, is 1, security and privacy, which includes encryption, privacy policies, features like aliasing, and also their history. Functionality and features is 2, how user-friendly it is. As much as we don't like Gmail, it is very easy to use. The 3rd thing is cost. Ideally, there are free plans so that it's accessible, kind of like Gmail, but we gotta be fair because we need sustainable business models so that they don't do the stuff Gmail is doing. And the 4th thing is just not being big tech. All providers today are not really big tech, so no need to worry, but this is definitely something I'll touch on for at least one of the providers. Let's ditch Gmail, starting with 5. Fastmail is definitely geared towards a mainstream audience. Security and privacy is good, not great, but it's good enough for most people. Overall, I define their goal is to give you just as good, if not better, usability than Gmail. So they've opted for more of a, we just promise to be better than Google kind of position. And I think that's fair for what they're trying to do. They have a paid business model, so they don't have to do shady things like Google does. They have aliasing as well as solid basic security, but they're not necessarily the best because they leave out features like native end-to-end encryption, and they're also not open source, and they lack some nifty privacy and security features that we're gonna cover later. So again, better than Gmail, but not the best on this list. In terms of functionality and features, I would argue it's hands down the best on this list. It's the most user-friendly with some amazing clients. It's fast, easy to use, and has solid integration on every operating system, as well as contacts and calendar, which is both open and competitive to what you'd find maybe on the Google side of things. So very impressed. Now, Fastmail is a paid service starting at $6 a month, but they offer a 30-day free trial without a credit card, so it's pretty easy to at least try to see if it's for you. Recapping pros and cons, pros, definitely an excellent set of features and also great usability, reliable, fast performance, many people love it, and it's probably the best search and spam filtering on this list since it lacks encrypted mailboxes, which means that they can get away with making this features a lot better than other providers. In terms of cons, it's paid only, and I would say definitely less emphasis on privacy and security, but still better than Gmail. And also it's not open source, so if you want something open source, this is probably not the best thing for you. If your goal is to be just as usable as Gmail, but just from a non-big tech company that cares a bit more about your data, I think that's kind of where Fastmail has positioned itself. 4 is the tinkering user's best friend, and it's mailbox.org, which really focuses on customization and kind of just throwing an abundance of features at you. It's almost like a little office suite, actually. So security can be pretty solid if you enable their encrypted mailbox feature, which is a bit more of a DIY way to get this outside of the options we'll cover later, which typically just do this by default. They do support OpenPGP as well, which similarly is a bit more DIY than other options in this list. And they also support cash by mail for payment, so you do get some better privacy. As I kind of hinted at, functionality is a big thing they kind of target. They have cloud storage, collaborative editing, contacts, calendar, video conferencing, and the extensive customization can be a bit overwhelming, and I personally don't like that about it, but I know some people love something that they can tinker with. But no matter who you are, I think the lack of dedicated mobile apps is going to be a big drawback for usability. In terms of pricing, mailbox.org offers a 30-day free trial with plans starting at a very affordable €1 per month. And their standard plan is €3 per month, which is extremely competitive. I think mailbox.org overall has some of the best pricing on the list today. Recapping pros and cons, pros is there's a strong privacy focus and a commitment to data protection. It's eco-friendly and has a lot of sustainable practices. There's a suite with cloud storage, calendar, and office tools. Even if you don't want those, they're there, and it's pretty out of the way if you don't want them. And it's a good value. In terms of cons, it is paid only. There is no free plan. The interface is definitely less polished than competitors, so it's going to be kind of a transition from Gmail, and it might be a bit overwhelming to use. It lacks mobile clients, so you have to depend on third-party clients. I would say definitely a worthwhile option to try out for more moderate to advanced users. 3 is Startmail, which is pretty underrated as it provides, in my opinion, a really good balance between privacy and usability, offering end-to-end encryption with a password option for external users, so you can just send it to anybody, even if they don't use Startmail. There's unlimited aliases, and they have PGP support. So they have these cool privacy features, but the interface I also find to be extremely user-friendly, and it comes, you know, not quite there, but it's pretty close to Fastmail's usability, but with stronger privacy. But it lacks features like a calendar, and it also, kind of like mailbox.org, doesn't have dedicated mobile apps, which is a significant downside, which definitely takes away some of the charm of Startmail. Now, Startmail is a paid-only service, and it starts at $7 a month, making it the priciest option on this list with only a 7-day trial. Annual can save you a little bit of money, but it's still a bit pricey, and I like to compare things by month to keep it even Steven. So to recap pros and cons, I'd say the pros is there's definitely a good focus on privacy and security, much better than Gmail. It does have a fairly user-friendly interface, and I'd say it just strikes that, you know, usability and security balance very well. The cons is that it is paid only, and it is definitely the priciest on this list. It lacks some of the features of other providers like calendar and cloud storage. It lacks mobile clients, and it's not open source. Startmail's kind of in an interesting place because they do a good job of bridging the very intense privacy and security services with the usability of the not so intense services. I think that if you find the next two options too extreme for your privacy and security, but you want something that's a bit more private and secure than Fastmail, then I'd say maybe Startmail's for you. But it's kind of in this awkward place where I think people who really value privacy are going to find something better, and people who really value usability are going to find something better. It just leaves them in a weird spot. Service number two is Tuta, which used to be Tuta Nota, which is fully cross-platform and open source with a strong focus on privacy. They are encrypted mailboxes, and you can do end-to-end encrypted with external users. Also, something really cool about Tuta is they support Monero, which I think is awesome. They actively support open source communities like F-Droid, which I super appreciate. Now, typically in the past, I've criticized them for not having the best usability, but I will say their usability is slowly but surely improving with dedicated apps for features like calendar as well. So here's their calendar app, which they're now making their own thing, and they've rolled out desktop clients, and all their clients are slowly getting better. With that said, the interface can still feel less polished than some other options on this list, and some users may encounter occasional bugs. I know I've stumbled on a couple even in this last week. With that said, it is overall very simple and functional. Cost is also a huge plus because they have a really generous free plan over here and a solid sub €4 option that would be more than great for most people. In terms of pros, definitely fantastic for privacy and security. It's open source, generous free tier, cross-platform, and its cheapest paid plan for less than €4 per month is a great value. In terms of cons, limited search functionality in the free version and just general usability sacrifices. You can see these here if you look at the chart. There are less features than some paid options if you compare paid to paid, and I would still say the interface has a ways to go to match the best options on this list, and I would love to see them get there. Personally, the people I've seen who connect best with Tuta are people who aren't using email all day. They don't need advanced features. They just want something simple that works and has really good privacy and security just built in so they don't have to think about it. And they also don't want like a massive suite. They just want something simple, just works. A lot of those people also tend to gravitate towards like smaller, more grassroots style projects, and they really like the small feel of Tuta and how it's run by an organic team that seems to care about what they do. So I think people who are more like activists really like the vibe and feeling of Tuta. Now, real quick, before I get into the top option, I'm going to cover three honorable mentions. So while moving away from Gmail is a great step, it's good to think about personal notes, ideas, and sensitive information, which you might still use Google and other big tech companies for. Notesnook is an open source, end-to-end encrypted note-taking app that prioritizes your privacy above all else. Unlike many other note-taking apps that collect and sell your data, they ensure that your notes are completely private and accessible only to you. It's cross-platform for every major device out there, including just the web. I just demoed it on CubesOS on the last video that we put out. And it has tons of advanced functionality, like an offline mode, rich text formatting, powerful search, and some fancier tools that you can see here on the screen. So if you're looking for a note-taking app that aligns with your commitment to more privacy and control away from big tech, I really recommend Notesnook. Check them out down in the description or at notesnook.com. And now let's dive back into the honorable mentions and, of course, the top Gmail alternative. Honorable mention one is MailFence. They offer a suite of email and document storage appealing to any of you who might seek just privacy. I'd say that's most of their branding that you're going to find here. It's privacy and security. Its interface seems a little bit less modern, but its commitment to open standards and privacy definitely makes it a consideration. And it also has a free plan, so there's really no harm in giving it a shot to see if it works for you. It's kind of a tradition that there's always at least one service that I mispronounce, and I feel like this video it's gonna be Posteo or Posteo. Someone let me know what it is. But they stand for privacy and sustainability, and they offer encrypted email with minimal data collection. Its feature set is simpler compared to some others on the list today, and there is no free plan, but a nice addition is that they accept cash by mail, and it's designed so you only ever pay what you need. And the third honorable mention before we touch on the top choice today is RiseUp, who provides secure and encrypted email services, as well as some other things that you can see here. It's a broader organization than just email, but they do offer email. And while it's an invite-only system and it's got a less friendly interface that might be a barrier for you, its commitment to digital freedom is really undeniable. They're a fantastic organization, and I've personally loved them and been following them for a long time. Now, as many of you might have expected, ProtonMail is my top pick. It shares Tuta's cross-platform support, and it's end-to-end encrypted, like Tuta, all while being open source, like Tuta, with the exception of ProtonMail's encryption being compatible with open standards like PGP. One thing I really prefer about Tuta that Proton doesn't do for privacy is Tuta accepts Monero, which is kind of a gold standard we have today in terms of private transactions online. The other difference from Proton and Tuta is that Proton is, I think, a bit more robust and feature-rich in terms of the experience, and it's a slightly more comparable to Gmail in terms of its usability. There are also more of an ecosystem, so you're going to find a VPN, you're going to find cloud storage, password manager, calendar, and even a Bitcoin wallet now. So this suite and integration is a strong selling point for those of you seeking a comprehensive Google replacement, but it might also have the opposite effect if you want something to just feel smaller and more grassroots. It's worth reminding that they have over 500 employees, and so they are definitely more corporate, and their blogs and the way they present themselves is very much corporate and almost similar to how a lot of big tech companies present themselves. In terms of pricing, they have a very similar generous free plan, kind of like Tuta, with paid plans being a bit more expensive than Tuta, starting at about $5 a month, which is, I'd say, pretty average for the services we've talked about today. The big difference with pricing is that they're definitely going to push you towards their paid ecosystem plans, which are by far the most expensive, but you also get the most for those. So the way that Proton structures it, they really want you to get into their ecosystem and use the full suite. Again, can be a pro, can be a con, depending on who you are. Let's recap pros and cons for ProtonMail. So the pros, end-to-end encryption with a strong privacy focus. It's a user-friendly interface. They have strong mobile apps. In terms of cons, I would say limited functionality in the free version. And that's kind of it. I don't have many more cons for ProtonMail. Now, there are two potential pros or cons. So these can swing either way just because of how polarizing they are. So the suite is definitely the first one. I'd say some people really want that suite-like feel. They just want everything in one place, taken care of for them. And some people want more choice and they don't want to be thrown into another ecosystem and they want to just have an email service. So that's the first either pro or con, depending on who you are. And I'd say the second thing is the size and the way that ProtonMail feels. If I didn't know any better, I would say it almost feels like a big tech company in itself. For some people, that kind of goes against what they want in an email provider, especially if they're ditching Gmail, whereas some people might still want kind of the reliability and the sustainability and knowing that this is a massive project with a lot of funding and a lot of people behind it to make it reliable. It can go either way, really depends on you and what you're looking for. Overall, I'd say there's nothing quite like Proton out there. No one's actually been able to build a privacy-respecting Google-like ecosystem. So what they're doing is very novel, very fresh, and no one's really been able to do anything like it before. So I think no matter what, it's worth trying the free plan to see if it works for you. And if it doesn't, there's a lot of other options on this list to pursue. So those are my five must-try Gmail alternatives that offer you an escape from Gmail. Remember that choosing these is really personal. So while I put these all in a list and other sites online put these in a list, you should always prioritize what works best for you. And I would take advantage of any free plans that you can to see if it works for you yourself. I've personally been on Proton since around 2017 and I'm really happy with them. But even for me, I've been playing around with Tuta and Fastmail lately to just kind of give them a shot and see how I feel about them and see if I want to migrate to them at some point. I'm still experimenting and I'll report in future videos if I decide to make any switches. One big pro tip for getting to the end of the video is I would recommend setting things up with a custom domain. Just buy any random domain you want. It could be your name. It could be something that people know you as. But if you set up these services with a custom domain, you can freely move between them. So rather than having henry@proton.com or henry@tuta.com and then needing to change my email for everything, I can just buy henry.com. from and set that up with any email provider I wish, and I can move between them without needing to give out a new email. I recommend everyone sets this up if they can. Now, you will find clearly labeled opt-in affiliate links for some of the providers in the description, which helps support the creation of content like this, so check that out. And also remember that for the strongest privacy and security in your communications, you probably want a dedicated messenger built from the ground up. Email is not really designed to be that private and secure, and dedicated messengers can be far better. I want to thank Notesnook for sponsoring this content. They're a great end-to-end encrypted notes provider, and there's a link to them down in the description. I want to thank all our Techlorians, who are the supporters who make this kind of content possible. They're contributing to us, they get access to our private communities on Signal, they get to vote on upcoming content, and there's a lot of other fun perks for joining, so join that below. And I want to thank you all for watching, and to also check out my Linux tier list if you want my thoughts on the best Linux distros to try. Check it out there, and I'll see you in that video, and I'll see you next time on Tech.